4 factorial equals 4 times 3 times 2 times 1, and it works the same way for other positive integers. But what is 0 factorial? Many of us might first guess that it should be 0, but actually we define it to be 1. Let's see why this definition makes sense in 5 different levels, ranging from a quick counting argument to explanations from calculus and beyond. For level 1, let's think about what factorials mean in terms of counting. 4 factorial tells us the number of ways to arrange 4 distinct objects in a row. Any of the 4 objects can be picked first, but once we've picked one, now there's only 3 remaining objects to be picked second. Then there are 2 remaining, and lastly, 1. We multiply all these values to get 4 factorial, which counts the number of possible permutations of these 4 objects. So what is 0 factorial? This counts the number of ways to arrange 0 objects in a row. For example, how many ways are there to put 0 flags on a flagpole? Well, there's one way, putting no flags on the pole. It's possible to arrange 0 objects, there's just only this one trivial way to do it. For level 2, let's think algebraically. 4 factorial is 4 times 3 times 2 times 1. To find 3 factorial, we need to remove the 4. So in other words, 3 factorial equals 4 factorial divided by 4. Then the 4s cancel and we're left with just 3 times 2 times 1. Then to get to 2 factorial, we divide 3 factorial by 3, leaving us with just 2 times 1. To get 1 factorial, we divide 2 factorial by 2. So how do we get 0 factorial? We need to divide by 1. So 0 factorial equals 1 factorial divided by 1, which equals 1. This shows us a common convention in math that an empty product is equal to 1. We removed all the numbers in our original product, and what we're left with is 1, the multiplicative identity. Multiplying by the empty product should not change the original value, so it should be the same as multiplying by 1. I think some of the confusion arises because an empty sum is equal to 0. Say we're adding 3 plus 2 plus 1. When we remove the 3, we subtract it, and then we subtract the 2, and then we subtract the 1, then what we're left with is 0, the additive identity. Adding 0 doesn't change a value, so an empty sum should equal 0. But for multiplication, the identity is 1, so an empty product, like 0 factorial, should equal 1. For level 3, let's talk about why we would even need 0 factorial in the first place. Let's say we have 5 distinct objects, and we want to choose 2 of them to take with us. The order doesn't matter, only which 2 we decide to take. There are 5 choices for the first object we pick, and then 4 choices for the second. That's 5 times 4. But since we said that the order of the objects doesn't matter, we've actually overcounted by a factor of 2 factorial. So we get 5 times 4 divided by 2 factorial. This is called a combination, and often we would write it as 5 factorial divided by 3 factorial times 2 factorial, which is an equivalent formula. Here is the combination formula for choosing k out of n distinct objects, where the order doesn't matter. So what happens if we want to pick all 5 objects out of the 5 available? There's just one way to do that, to take all of them. The formula is 5 factorial divided by 0 factorial times 5 factorial. The 5 factorials cancel out, but we also want the 0 factorial to equal 1. If it didn't, we'd have to have a separate case for when we choose all of the objects or none of them. By defining 0 factorial to be 1, the combination formula continues to work in those cases. For level 4, let's look at a situation in calculus where it's again convenient to define 0 factorial to be 1. In calculus, we learn how to approximate functions with Taylor polynomials. This is a way for us to approximate a complicated function around a point with a polynomial, like a line or a quadratic function. For example, here's the Taylor polynomial of degree 3 that approximates the function e to the x near 0. Notice the factorials in the denominators. If we define 0 factorial to be 1, then the pattern continues for this first term in the Taylor polynomial without needing to have a separate special case. This allows us to have a nice formula that covers all the terms in a Taylor polynomial. For level 5, let's talk about extending factorials to real numbers. We'd like to find a function that matches the factorials for all the natural numbers, but also fills in the gaps in a nice continuous way. There are actually multiple ways to do that, but the most commonly used is called the gamma function. Gamma of z is defined to be the integral from 0 to infinity of t to the z minus 1 times e to the negative t dt. This means we'll find the area underneath that curve between 0 and infinity. If you've had some calculus, you can use integration by parts to check that for any natural number n, gamma of n equals n minus 1 factorial. If we graph the gamma function but shift it left by 1, then it lines up perfectly with the factorials of the natural numbers. Now what about 0 factorial? This matches with gamma of 1. This integral is particularly nice because the first factor is t to the 0, which is 1. So we get the integral from 0 to infinity of e to the negative t dt. This is a classic calculus problem, and this integral equals 1. So the gamma function provides another reason to define 0 factorial to be 1. We can also use the gamma function to define a generalized factorial of other real numbers. For example, if we want a generalized factorial of 1 half, we can say that that's equal to gamma of 3 halves, which it turns out is the square root of pi over 2. This is why some math software, like Wolfram Alpha, for example, will evaluate 1 half factorial as the square root of pi over 2. Do you have another way of thinking about 0 factorial? Let us know in the comments. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.